Greetings, comrades! Today we'll be talking about space once again. My beloved Dmitry Rogozin has made yet another statement about how Russia will finally get the better of everyone in space and put them in their places. Russia is withdrawing from the ISS project and is going to launch its own space station in 2025. Let's talk about it. Is this a political decision only, or is the ISS really becoming obsolete and dangerous to stay on? Can Russia even build a modern space station on its own today? And why is it all Elon Musk's fault once again? So the International Space Station was launched in 1998 by the Russian and US space agencies and has been hailed for its exemplary cooperation involving numerous countries. Roscosmos' agreement with the international partners runs out in 2024. A decision on the ISS future will then be made depending on the condition of its technical modules, which have reached the end of their service life, and on Russia's plans for its own orbital service station. It seems logical and easily understandable. The Russian part of the ISS is indeed rapidly aging, and it would make sense to build a new station, and if Russia can do it itself, then why not? But it's not that simple, actually. After all, the USSR already had its own space station, Mir. So why was it sunk into the ocean and Russia had to share the space station with other countries for over 20 years? Why was it not profitable to build a space station of their own back then and now suddenly it is profitable? So, a moment of history. Let's try to understand why humanity needs space station in the first place. So imagine, mankind has gone into space. Yay! And then again, and again, and then even reached the moon. But although spaceships were, to put it mildly, not the most comfortable places to be inside of, it was impossible to live normally on them for humans. So in 1971, the Soviet Union launched the first ever space station into Earth orbit, Salyut 1. In fact, an orbital station is also a spaceship, but unlike a normal spacecraft, the station is designed for a long stay in Earth orbit. It can operate autonomously for many months or even years, and inside it there is enough space to organize scientific experiments and some quality leisure time for cosmonauts. Not to say that Salyut 1 was very comfortable. The cosmonauts stayed there only for 22 days, and their return to Earth ended tragically. But still, a new round of space exploration has begun. Subsequently, new orbital stations, both civil and military, were sent into space. Salyut 3 flew for 213 days in 1974-1975, although of the two expeditions only one succeeded, the second ship was unable to dock. Then came Salyut 4, Salyut 5, Salyut 6 and Salyut 7. And every new station set records both for time in Earth orbit and for time of habitability. And then came the era of a famous Mir station, the first multi-module manned orbital station. In fact, it was also a Salyut, Salyut 8. This station was basically the Soviet answer to the US space shuttle program in the eternal space race. Yes, it was not a direct response because the Soviet equivalent, Buran, failed. But we beat the US and built a station that they could not. At one time, actually, there were two space stations in Earth's orbit at once, Salyut 7 and Mir. The first people on Mir, then still single module, were Soyuz T-15 crew members, Leonid Kizim and Vladimir Solovyov. Their spacecraft docked with Mir, the cosmonauts brought the station into working order, and a month and a half later they undocked and flew to Salyut 7. They spent another month and a half on Salyut before returning to Mir once again. In fact, this was the first human flight between two space stations. Space bases sounds like something from science fiction, to be honest. But let's go back to the harsh reality. The Mir station, for all its brilliance, was designed for only 3 or 5 years of operation. But in the end it worked for 15 years. So why didn't Russia send a new station of our own to the Earth's orbit and instead have agreed to the ISS project? Actually, the answer is simple. The problems with space funding in Russia in the 90s. Almost all of Russia's space money back then came from flying foreign astronauts on Russian spacecrafts and from launching commercial satellites. Therefore, Russia had no extra funds to build a new station, and it became increasingly difficult to maintain Mir in a viable state. Some small parts kept breaking down, and you have to understand that fixing even the smallest problem in space is always millions of dollars in extra costs. On the whole, the same thing is happening with the ISS today. The five Russian ISS modules are the oldest and most worn out in the entire station. So there are more and more technical issues with the ISS, including occasional air leaks in the Russian segments. RCS Energia has predicted an exponential growth of the number of such problems starting in 2022. Maintenance of the station after that date will cost 10 to 15 billion rubles annually. This is only 3 times less than the deployment of a new station would cost, given that it will last much longer than the perpetually patched up modules of the already rather old ISS. It would once again seem that everything is absolutely logical and understandable. But can Russia even make its own station now? They apparently are not able to send a mere Nauka module to the ISS for 25 years. To answer briefly, yes, it can. Russia can easily create such modules, for example from parts of the first stage of the Proton rocket. Besides, in fact, 2 modules for the future station have already been created and are almost ready to be sent into orbit. Now let's talk about the financial component. If we look at the financial experience of our transoceanic partners, it will become clear that their experiments on the ISS cost them lots of money. $9 million per astronaut per day. Now let's pretend that the US has its own national space station that don't need to be shared with anyone. It is estimated that the same experiments would cost around $3 million a day on such station. 3 times less. Skylab could have been such station for the US. But in the 70s, Americans had no tools to carry their astronauts to Skylab consistently. Unfortunately, the data on the cost of flights to Mir is still classified, but by all accounts, they were even cheaper. And the productivity of astronauts on a mononational space station will always be higher than that on a multinational one, because there is no need to coordinate flight schedules, experiments and so on with anyone. But wait, if everything is so bad and unprofitable with the ISS, then why did the US in the 90s even agree to build the ISS with Russia's participation, instead of building their own station? They had money back then. The answer is simple. It was because they still had no consistent way to fly there. Already since 1986, after the Challenger disaster, it has become clear that the shuttles are accidentally dangerous. After each accident, the US stopped flights for years. And why would you need your own space station if you may have to abandon it for several years at any time? There was no such problem with the ISS. You could always pay the Russians and use their spacecraft. And now there's Elon Musk with his fairly reliable Dragons. In parallel with the Dragons and their Falcon carriers, the US is developing 2 more new ships and missiles for them. If one type proves to be a failure, the other will be used. Consequently, the US now has no need for inexpensive transport carrying their people to an orbital station. Accordingly, it now makes sense to the US to build all their new space stations by themselves. Foreign astronauts would be able to fly there, if at all, only as guests, as foreigners flew to the Soviet or Russian Mir. So in fact, it was basically Elon Musk and his Dragons who forced Russia to build its own new orbital station. So now the following picture is emerging. 1. The ISS is becoming obsolete. 2. If the US builds a new orbital station, most likely they will do it single-handedly, without international partners. 3. Russia can build a new station of their own too. 4. A new national station would be cheaper for Russia than another international space project. So what is the problem then? There is only one problem left. In my opinion, orbital stations are an obsolete concept, and in fact, they are not really needed in today's world. They are only needed until Elon Musk's Starship begins regular flights. The internal habitable volume of such a spacecraft in orbit is equal to that of the entire ISS, and much larger than the volume of the future Russian station. And Russian new station is highly unlikely to be in space before Starship gets there. This means we are building something that will be fundamentally obsolete from the get-go. The most sensible investment for the Russian space industry today would be to forego building a new orbital station and focus all available funds on building an equivalent of Starship. Because as of today, Russian super-heavy rockets are at maximum at the mock-up stage and hopelessly lag behind their US counterparts. It will still have to be done someday. But if on the way we will spend more money on unnecessary orbital station, then we risk losing both money and time. But unfortunately, Dmitry Rogozin is the head of Roscosmos, not me. So we are building a new space station.